Good morning, church. I'm Henry. For those of you who are guests, I've been a member of the church for a couple of years. My wife and I, Tara, emigrated from England a couple of years ago. And my late mother-in-law attended this church. She was a minister in the Uniting Church, and she said, "This is a great church." And we came a couple of times, and my sister-in-law, Micheline, also attends here. And we've loved it ever since. So we highly recommend this as a home. In fact, I've met a couple of people who've been here for a few months and have said they're starting to call it home. So welcome if you're new, and of course, for regulars, I'm going to be just sharing a very simple Christmas message. It's probably a message that you've heard before. By the way, Bob, you've got that glow again, and I can see why. Personal joke. Anyway. The birth of Jesus. Of course, this is Christmas Eve. Oh, by the way, today is my mother's birthday, but African style. Basically, her mother was illiterate, so she didn't know when my mom was born, so they said, "We'll make it Christmas Eve." And so it is. So I've got to call my mom later, but it's a special day in our family. But of course, tomorrow's Christmas. Today is the day before. It's not even the evening, but we'll call it Christmas Eve because it lords in this amazing act of God coming to earth in the form of a baby. So I'm going to read the rather lengthy Luke 2 chapter, which talks about the arrival of Jesus. So bear with me. You've probably heard it before if you're a Christian, because it's the Christmas sort of passage. But it's replete, it's full, it's pregnant with so much truth in it, and so much reason for us to be absolutely over the moon about what's happening at Christmas. "In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. And the angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said unto them," and maybe this is the heart of this passage, and maybe this is the heart of what Bob was sharing, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those to whom his favor rests.' When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, 'Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that the angel has talked about, which the Lord has told us.' So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. On the eighth day, when it was time to circumcise the child, he was named Jesus, the name the angel had given him before he was conceived." So, the meaning of Christmas kind of somewhat gets blurred in our modern world, doesn't it? It's full of commercializing of the season, and also secularism has crept in. You're going to hear songs about Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, songs about letting it snow, which will never happen in Australia. Songs about Santa. Now, these things aren't necessarily evil in of themselves, of course, but no more than human traditions, but they just blur the meaning of that angel's message. Great joy. This strong language used in the angel's announcement. So the two mistakes we can make, we can be in the anti-Christmas camp, and there are some Christians who are in that camp. They say it's the wrong date. It's the wrong season. Actually, it's a pagan holiday. It's sun worship. Santa is actually the word Satan with the words jumbled up. We can fall into the other camp, of course, which is to completely exclude God from everything. We strip God from all our vocabulary. And the world is very good at this. So, you know, all the TV adverts, they'll talk about the message of Christmas, the spirit of Christmas. They'll spell Christmas with an X. They talk about the broad themes of how it's a time for giving. It's a time for family get-togethers with all our racist in-laws. And all its human traditions like turkey, mistletoe, holly, and ivy. Exchanging of gifts. We can talk about, again, the spirit of Christmas, which revolves around doing kind random acts to strangers especially. We can watch those movies that talk about Santa saving Christmas by ensuring everyone gets their gifts on time. I mean, what a bizarre concept. A big, fat white man going down a billion chimneys and still coming out looking white. I mean, I don't get it. But again, it's not evil or wrong. It's just blurred. So whichever camp you're in, and you may well be balanced and sit right in the middle and sort of look at both sides and go, well, yeah, and you know what the deal is. The bottom line is this story is amazing. It is absolutely replete with an extraordinary truth that God took on human flesh. Theologians call it the incarnation, big word. Basically means God becomes a man. He becomes human, and he lives among us. One of the Lord's titles, we've already touched on this actually, Rob touched on it and Barb touched on it, but one of the titles given to God is Emmanuel, which means God with us, literally, physically, but also on our side, so to speak. So you have this fully God, fully human being born in a manger. No pomp and ceremony, born amongst animals, and the people that witnessed were just humble shepherds. In a funny way, it was the fulfillment of a very ancient prophecy uttered many, many years ago by a prophet called Isaiah. If we turn to Isaiah 7:14, I'm not saying do that, but I'm just saying, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel. So the Bible is replete with signs. I don't know if you've noticed that, but things that point you to the truth. It's God's way of verifying and authenticating who he is. In other words, God uses prophecy to be a signpost to anyone who's got an open heart that God is who he says he is. He does what he says he will do. And because of that, he's utterly trustworthy with all his promises. That if he says, I will do this, and he does it, you go, ah, he's a truth teller. He does. He means what he says, and he always does it right, and it always comes true. And you know, in a funny way, simply trusting that God is a truth teller earns a lot of respect for you with him. Do you know that? It's an extraordinary thing that if you just say, I've seen the prophecy, it's true, therefore God must be a truth teller, that act of faith of just trusting God earns you incredible favor with God. The book of Hebrews 11 verse 6, I believe, says this, that without faith it is impossible to please God, for anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. So God takes this thing called faith, which means trusting him, and he makes it have such value, and we'll just look at that in a second, that he exalts it over anything else, over good works and charities and all the other things that you think that we would think, this will give me favor with God. God, no, no, no. Just trusting him and believing in him opens doors with God. In our modern world, we have a review system. If a company promises one thing and delivers less than they promise, we've got systems, ways in which we can tell people to avoid them. We can go to these rating sites, review sites, and give them a very low rating. Google's one of them, of course. You can email your friends or you can post on random forums. But basically, you're saying, buyer beware. They promise one thing, but they don't deliver. It's really misleading, and we can report them to the ombudsman, or we can get in touch with Consumer Affairs or those TV shows and say that, you know, they didn't deliver what they promised. It's a violation of my consumer rights, etc. And so God understands this problem of human skepticism, of people who overpromise and underdeliver. So he says, I'll give you pointers, I'll give you signs, I'll give you arrows that substantiate who I am. I will do what I promise. And so I'm going to predict it before it happens. So when it happens, you can recognize that the thing I promised has come true. And so when you look back, you can see that prophecy has been fulfilled. You can see what I've done. I will, as it were, paint history in advance for you. Isaiah 46, verse 8 says this, remember this, keep it in mind, take it to heart, you rebels. Remember the former things, those of long ago. So God's saying, remember what's happened in the past. He says, I'm God and there's no other. I think that's God boasting, right? That there's no other God. He is the only one. I am God and there is none like me. I make known the end from the beginning, from ancient times. What is still to come, I say, my purpose will stand and I will do all that I please. So God says, I'll show you what I'm going to do. But in prophecy, I'm also going to reveal what you're like. And I'm also going to show you what you have to do in response to what I've shown you. And all of these things must lead us to one central message, that God is trustworthy. God can be believed. Jesus in his earthly ministry fulfilled many prophecies that were read, or it was said they were according to the scriptures. According, in other words, to the predictions or the prophecies. So prophecies are a big deal in the Word of God. And the gospel writers wanted to show that the virgin conception was not something new, but it had been predicted hundreds and hundreds of years earlier. God is now with the people to save them, just as the prophets had predicted. So for the people of that time, this was a big deal. They were looking forward hundreds of years, not knowing, when is this child going to come? When is this Messiah going to come? And in a sliver of time, boom. God enters our world. Far from being distant and apart, exalted in heaven, elevated, separated from man by distance, God was now suddenly in our midst. He came here as a tangible human being that people could touch and feel. He humbled himself, became a baby, a vulnerable baby, a hybrid of the divine and the earthly. And his primary mission then was to come as a savior. Luke 2:14, glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests. Reconciliation between us and God. Peace because there's a problem, the sin problem. We should be recipients of God's judgment, but this baby comes to bring us peace with our Creator, the one who made everything. So those on whom God's favor is, it begs the question, so who are they? Are they some elite bunch? What do you have to do to be a part of this group on whom God's favor rests? The Bible tells us God has no favorites. So it's not the tall guys or the good-looking gals. It's not the people who are born in Australia, even though I know you'd love that, but it's simply people who follow what God says they should do. Romans 6, verse 23, for the wages of sin is death. Now, I've read this many times in the NIV, but I came across the Darby translation today, yesterday when I was researching this. The Darby? Anyway, it says, but the act of favor of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Almost as if God's gift, the other versions say, but the gift of God is eternal life. This says, but the act of favor of God is eternal life. So it's kind of equating a gift with favor. Now, our problem, of course, is we earn things. Most human beings understand the concept of you do work and you get paid for it. And so the idea of receiving something for nothing makes us a little skeptical, even though that's what we do at Christmas. We give each other gifts. And it would be silly if you gave someone a gift and they said, oh, yes, $10. How much did it cost you? And try to pay for it. So there's a dual sort of message in this scripture here, in this very passage, in which it's saying there's the favor of God, which is given. It's unmerited, it's undeserved. It's a gift, but yet it's also something God bestows upon you as favor. And so how do you become a recipient of the favor, I guess, is a good question. John 1, verse 12, very simple. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. That's a strong word. The right to become children of God. The right. Everybody say the right. One, two, three, go. Say the left. I just wanted to see if anyone would say it, that's all. But the right. You have the ability without favoritism. If you choose to believe in Jesus' name, believe in his person, and receive him, he gives you the right. Now, in our modern day, we know what we're entitled to, don't we? What our rights are. Very much a Western thing. Where I come from, people's rights are trodden on. But here's God, the owner of all things, who's saying, if you simply receive this Jesus, you receive this baby and all that he represents, his life, his death on the cross, you earn, you deserve. I don't even know how to put that because you can't earn it, but you receive the favor of God for receiving Jesus. It's amazing. It's extraordinary. Without partiality, without judgment, without favoritism, whoever you are, whatever your background is, whatever you've done, receive him, you're in. So just like the shepherds who received the news and believed the angel's message, or the magi, the wise men, or the kings, whatever you want to call them, who traveled from the east, we ought to respond, I suggest, may I put it to you, with great reverence, and also have our hearts leap inside us. It must be an emotional experience to understand what happened at Christmas. It mustn't be passé about it. It mustn't be blasé, apathetic. This is great news, like the angel said. None of our traditions take sin away, trust me. The promise of Christmas is that if you will gladly receive Jesus with great joy, God's favor rests on you. Not for what you've done, but because he's lavishly bestowing this free gift to anyone who will receive it. There is great darkness around us, no doubt about that. But that's no different to the world in which this Jesus arrived in. It was an evil time. There were great oppressors oppressing the nation of Israel. Jesus, at a very young age, had to flee to Egypt. There was a despot in charge who tried to kill him. And only when that despot died did the angel appear to Joseph and say, you can go back. Jesus wasn't born into a world without modern conveniences. There was darkness and evil around even back then, and throughout his life they tried to kill him. But God's plan still stood. Sadly, 2,000 years ago, most of the planet wasn't ready to receive their Messiah. After all, he didn't arrive with great pomp and ceremony. It wasn't like he was announced on Facebook or Twitter. He kind of gently entered the world. If you didn't look, you wouldn't have seen it. You wouldn't have noticed. He lives a sinless life and eventually dies on a cruel Roman cross to fulfill God's ultimate plan. That's to save you and to save me. That's why he's a savior. He's not a savior because he's a baby in a manger. That's how he started. But his life's mission was reconciliation, to grant us eternal life and forgiveness of sins and peace with God. And the weird thing is, even this faith that you have to place in Jesus is a gift from God as well. So it's not as if you have to do a lot of work and go, okay, so I want the favor of God, I just need to trust him. Even that faith that starts to ignite inside of you, even that excitement you start to feel about the story, even that, oh, if this is true, I want in, even that is a gift from God. So there's very little work you have to do to become a Christian. You just have to be excited by the possibility that it's true. And God seems to do the rest. He energizes faith in you, which gives you the ability to believe. Then there's something you have to do. God has revealed what he's done in the past, what he's going to do in the future, but there's a response you have to make. You and I have to believe and receive. And there are many ways we can do that, and we'll explore that right at the end of the message. There's good news and there's bad news. That gift of a baby is wonderful for all people who get it. It's extraordinary, actually, that God would die for you and me, take our place, the wretched sinners that we are. But there's bad news for those who reject the gift, for those who look at the baby as irrelevant. Because the bad news is this little baby grew up into a man who died on a cruel Roman cross. But the Bible says in the book of Philippians 2 that he has been exalted to the greatest, highest place. He's been given a name above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So God is going to send Jesus back at the end of time as a victorious, all-conquering king, and he's going to gather everyone who's ever lived, and he's going to have them in one place and going to judge them. There's going to be a great judgment at the end of time. It's called the Great White Throne Judgment. Revelation 20 says this. And it's a scripture that gives me great sadness. From verse 11, "Then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. The earth and the heavens fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life." Now, great and small means everybody. It goes from the greatest to the least that have ever lived. If they ever lived, they'll be there. The queen, presidents, prime ministers, great leaders, athletes, actors, singers, great names in science, all the people who have ever existed and breathed will be before the Lord. Another book was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books. The sea gave up the dead that were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them. And each person was judged according to what they had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. The lake of fire is the second death. Anyone, everybody say anyone. One, two, three, go. Anyone. Again, anyone. Sorry, it sounds juvenile when I do this, but it's to reinforce a point. Anyone whose name was not... Everybody say, was not. One, two, three. Was not. One, two, three. Was not. Anyone whose name was not found written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire. So, why the baby in a manger? It's to save you from the fire. You understand? Now, I'm not here to preach a heavy, sort of turn or burn kind of Christmassy message. No, this is good news. But that baby had to come to save us from something. He's the Savior, right? The angel declared that. The Savior. Savior from what? That. If your name is not found, you're in trouble. You get it? Do I need to explain? You're in trouble if your name is not found in the Lamb's Book of Life. The good news. The great news that gives us great joy. Revelation 21. "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth." Because remember, the first heaven and earth had fled away from his presence, so God's going to fix this place up. It's a bit broken, amen? You reckon? Things are a little bit wonky, yeah? We know things aren't straight. Because to know what's crooked or broken, you have to know what straight is, right? And so we know that this world is messed up. Even atheists who don't believe in God will say it's broken. It's a broken world, man. How do they know? I don't know. You've got to have a reference point, right? But anyway, it's broken. It's messed up. And so God, in his great power, wisdom, and creative ability, is going to make a new one. He's going to start from scratch. I don't know how he's going to do it, but we are going to see a new heaven and new earth. And we see the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband in verse 2. Verse 3 of Revelation 21. "And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people. And he will," God with us, again, Emmanuel. "And he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There'll be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." Isn't that good news, huh? Amen? I mean, that brings me great joy. There is no more death. There'll be no more, no more wrinkles, no more cellulite, no more... knee replacements. Oh, you put you out of business. And hips and all that sort of stuff that goes out of whack. None of that. God will eradicate all of that. Every single one of us are going to look amazing. We'll all be incredibly youthful because the curse has made this world broken. It's brought cancer into the world. It's brought mutations. It's brought birth defects. It's messed it up. That great fall that happened in the beginning when Adam and Eve rebelled from God, it opened the door to sin, and God's going to quarantine sin and he's going to place it in the lake of fire. And then he says this. He who was seated on the throne said, I'm making everything new. Then he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. So the God has already proved who he is, that he tells the truth all the time, reminds us. He says, these words are trustworthy and true. And he said, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit all of this, and I will be their God, and they'll be my children. Want to be a child of God, huh? How many of you would love to be? I mean, this is the coolest family in the world, huh? And you want to be a part of God's family, amen? There's a warning. These are the words of Jesus, by the way. There was an angel that came and spoke to John. And there's some texts in Revelation that are read. It's like the words of Jesus himself. And he says this, but the cowardly, this is the one who died for people. The unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, those who practice magic arts, the idolaters, and all liars, they will be consigned to the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death, again. I mean, listen, I've met people who believe, God's too kind, he's loving, you know. These are the words of Jesus. And by the way, that's forever. I've met people who think, maybe after a few thousand years, God squishes you out. Forever. I can prove it to you. You can come and have tea with me. If you're one of those universalists who think, everyone gets saved or God extinguishes your... Come, I'll show you all the scriptures. We can do that. But just take it from me. That's what the Bible says. It's forever. Baby doesn't have to come, live a sinless life, grow into a man who dies on a cross if there isn't something great we're being saved from. You understand? It makes no sense, folks. God's paid a high price to save us from nothing. This is what God's saving us from, the second death. Revelation 22, and I'm finishing. The Spirit and the bride say, verse 17, the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let the one who hears say, come. Let the one who's thirsty, we've heard that before, it's repeated from 21 in 22. If you're thirsty, let the one who wishes to take the free gift of the water of life. Again, no favoritism. Hey, if you're thirsty, if you get the message, if you understand God loves you, God wants you, and God says, you just have to want me too, God says you're in. But you've got to be thirsty. Main problem is a lot of people don't understand they're thirsty. I mean, it's weird, isn't it? Most people think, as long as you're a good person, you're okay. As long as you do good to everyone. As long as you don't sin too much. Jesus, you receive him or not? That he's the dividing, that baby in the manger is it. That Jesus who died on the cross, that's it. God died for you and me. So you better understand you're in a predicament. You have a problem. It's called sin. You can't fix it. You're stuck in the mud. You need to reach out to your Savior. And the reason we're excited as Christians about now is because that baby represents our salvation. So how will you stand before him on that day? Because it's going to happen. Just like every other prophecy. I promise you, I'm laying my reputation on this. Every prophecy of God that was predicted in the Old Testament has been fulfilled, and there are others that will be fulfilled. They are going to happen without a shadow of a doubt. They will happen. Now, I understand prophecies sometimes get confusing. You're like, was he talking about this? Was it about that time in history? Was it about now? Is it something we're looking forward to? I know. It kind of gets confusing. But what I can tell you is there are enough scriptures that say he's coming back. Amen? He's coming back. He's coming to judge the world. You better know which side you stand on. There's no room for fence sitting. That baby in a manger, you have to make a decision about him. That Jesus on a cross, you have to decide whether you want his love, his forgiveness, and his grace. So will you embrace that child? Will you be excited like the shepherds or the magi travel to go and see this baby who represents so much for all humanity? Well, you just carry on with your business, you know, playing on your PlayStation or your Wii or Xbox 360, or go fishing or golfing, do makeup, can't leave the ladies out of it, whatever it is that makes you miss the visitation of God. Will you carry on your business as if it's business as usual, much ado about nothing? Come on, folks, this is amazing. It's a time of great joy. The baby should bring a tear to your eye. If you're currently an unbeliever, I urge you to turn from your sin and cry out to this living God. Jesus wants to save you from eternal torment. He wants to give you a fresh start. We have rebelled against Him, our holy, extraordinarily infinite Creator, amazing, amazing God. But He had a plan, and He wants you to be part of it. But He has given us autonomy. We as human beings have, I guess, control over our own will. We can say yes, or we can say no. My suggestion to you is, be like the shepherds today. Be like the shepherds. Go and visit Jesus in the manger. And then follow the rest of the story. Because it is a story of great news. It's called the good news. It's the gospel. I have a good video to show you. I'm going to wait for Alex to unmute the audio because once in a while we start a video without the sound. But this video I came across a few days ago. Hey! Zach! Chelsea, is that you? Rewind. No! Right, I was just going to say, I came across this video the other day, and I felt the vibrations. I felt something. I really did. And Alex, I'm going to ask you to just turn it up louder than everything else that was playing earlier, because I really want you to feel what this season is all about. And once we're done, the worship team is going to go up and just, you know, do their thing just to keep some, give us some atmosphere. And if you've got any need, I want to suggest to you that that baby in a manger grew up to be a victorious champion who gave us His Holy Spirit, who wants to minister to whatever your need is. If you need Jesus today, come to the front, we'll pray with you. If you need healing, if you need breakthrough in any kind of way, please come to the front after the video plays. Thank you. Amen. Do you feel something? Yeah. Some of you got to do business with God right now. There's a lot at stake, folk. There's a lot at stake. So I want to declare today that if you do not know the Lord Jesus Christ, you're in a predicament. The Bible makes it very clear that God gave all he could give to reconcile you to him. About 25 years ago, about a week from today, 17th of December, this young man gave his life to the Lord Jesus Christ. I understood what was at stake, and I knew that God had gone to an extraordinary length to save me from it. And that extension of God's grace, those open arms, that olive branch, God is extending to you today if you do not know him. And so I want to suggest to you that one of the simple things you can do is just simply come to the front to receive prayer for that. We will gladly share with you, pray with you about how you can become a Christian. There may also be those of you who've strayed, you've walked away, you've become caught up in things you shouldn't be caught up in, or your heart has grown cold. You've, if as it were, lost your first love, that passion, that fire that once raged inside of you is barely glowing now. And God's saying now, today is the day of salvation. Don't put it off. Don't say, I'll do it next time. I'll do it next year. You may not have next time or next year. Today, receive the greatest gift. Not presents that are shared around lunch tomorrow afternoon, but receive that Jesus who came for your benefit, died on a cruel Roman cross, ultimately to reconcile you to him. If you were the only sinner in the world, he would still have come for you. If it was just you, he would have come for you. And trust me, friends, it doesn't matter how heinous a person you think you are. Jesus' arms are wide open. He says, come. He says, to all who would receive him, if you just receive him, he will give you the right to become a child of God. So come to the front, if you will. If you have any other needs, I want to encourage you as well to come. Don't be shy. Don't be self-conscious. Don't think about what people around you will think. This is a safe place. We've got people who are trained in praying with you. And please understand there's confidentiality here as well. So whatever you're struggling with or dealing with, it stays here. But don't postpone this. There's a real favor of God upon this time. He sent his son into the world. But Jesus, as I said, when he ascended to heaven, left us with his Holy Spirit. The person of the Trinity, if you will, who is the power of God. And he wants to invade your life. So whatever needs you have, come to the front. And if you just want to be blessed, if you just want to feel the power of God in your life, if you need a touch from heaven and everything is going great, come to the front as well. If you want to look forward to next year and pray that God's favor would rest upon you next year to turn things around, come to the front. Listen, if the whole church comes to the front, that's okay, okay? But please, don't hesitate. Come to the front. And all those who are trained in prayer ministry, please come to the front as well.